Let us invite Jesus to our worship service. Lord Jesus, our Creator, our Maker, our wonderful Savior, and soon coming King, Lord, we bow our heads and worship you. We invite you to this church now and take the seat of honor among us and bless us with your word and give us your instructions, your guidance, that we will be completely surrendered to you, to serve you always. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our scripture reading today comes from the book of Revelation, chapter 2, verses 1 to 7. To the angel of the church of Ephesus write, "These things says he who holds the seven stars in his right hand, who walks in the midst of the seven golden lampstands. I know your works, your labor, your patience, and that you cannot bear those who are evil, and that you have tested those who say they are apostles and are not, and have found them liars." Verse 3, "And you have persevered and have patience and have labored for my name's sake and have not become weary. Nevertheless, I have this against you, that you have left your first love. Remember, therefore, from where you have fallen, repent and do the first works, or else I will come to you quickly and remove your lampstand from its place, unless you repent. Verse 6, but this you have, that you hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. He who has a ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him who overcomes, I will give to eat from the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. May the Lord add his blessings to this reading.
Blessed Sabbath day to all of you. God bless you as you study God's word with me today. Today we are going to study about the church at Ephesus. This topic was given to me some time ago by Pastor Kion, who asked me to preach on the church of Ephesus. I was not really good in this particular topic because I realized that I did not complete my studies on the sanctuary. Remember, some time ago I spoke to you about the sanctuary in heaven. So I was thinking that he might ask me to preach on that line, but he did not. He said, you speak on this particular church, the church at Ephesus. And he gave me the scripture reading and everything, even though I was not prepared for it. But I accepted his challenge and I prayed over it. And by God's grace, I have come up with a message. Now, just now, we heard the reading of the scripture just now by Brother Anandan on the Ephesus church. Verse 1 says, unto the angel of the church at Ephesus write, these things saith he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, who walketh in the midst of seven golden candlesticks. Notice in verse 2, the very first words of Jesus, he says, I know thy works and thy labor. Here is something about the knowledge of Jesus. Jesus is all-knowing. He knows every little detail of the church. Nothing can be hidden from him. Every secret thing he knows. That's why he says, I know thy works and thy labors and thy patience, and how thou canst not bear them which are evil, which thou hast tried them, and which say they are apostles and are not, and found them to be liars. Now let me say a few things about Ephesus. Ephesus was a very big city in Asia Minor, next to Rome. That means Rome was the capital city in the Roman Empire. Ephesus was actually next to Rome in its prestige, in its position as a seaport and as a center for traders to travel through and so on. Ephesus was a great prosperous city in the days of Apostle Paul. And Apostle Paul had stayed there for nearly 2 years. In fact, he had spent more years in his ministry in Ephesus than in any other church. And he had spent a lot of time in that church because that was actually the capital area in Asia Minor, and he wanted to establish a strong church in that area. And no other place Paul had stayed longer than in Ephesus. Then he says, there are a few things I have against you. Speaking about the church in Ephesus, Jesus, the all-sufficient, all-knowing Savior says, I know thy works. And then he says in verse 4, nevertheless. Now certainly the church in Ephesus was a very hard-working church, very supportive of Paul's ministry. Now, by the way, that's where Paul had his encounter with the people who worshipped Diana. You remember in Acts, I think it's in chapter 18, there was a great riot created because the people in Ephesus were worshipping Diana, a statue, the Roman goddess of fertility. She's also known as Artemis. And for 2 hours, the people in the city of Ephesus, they cried, great is Diana, great is Diana. And they wanted to challenge all those who came against that city and their religion. And Paul was bringing in the gospel to that city, and people did not want to receive. But God used Paul to perform mighty miracles, and he had established the church through pain and suffering, and he has brought the key leaders of the city to Jesus. Verse 4, Jesus commenting about the church, he says, nevertheless. Now every time you see the word nevertheless, it shows that however. That means he says, you have worked very hard. You have put your best efforts, however, or nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee. Now this is the observation of our Savior Jesus Christ, who says, however, nevertheless, I have something against you. Thou hast left thy first love. Now this is the first comment that Jesus made about the church in Ephesus. You have left your first love. And then verse 5, he says, remember, therefore, from whence thou art fallen, and repent, and do the first works, or else I will come unto thee quickly and remove thy candlestick out of his place, except thou repent. The all-observing Savior Jesus says, there is something that has brought you down, and that is, he says, you have left thy first love. Now, the first love here refers to the zeal that the church had in the beginning. It has lost its zeal. It has lost its first love. Now, some of you may know what I mean by that. In our family life, we often go through this. When we first meet our spouses or our loved one, there is always the first love. But after some time, the first love fades away. And then comes this cold experience. And that's what Jesus is meaning here. You have left your first love. Now the word left, if you examine it very carefully, it has to do with the power of choice. No one leaves without making a choice. So the church has made a choice to leave the first love. Okay, let me go on with the next few verses before I come back to it again. Verse 6 says, but this thou hast, there is something, you have something in common with me, that thou hatest the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. Now, I looked into many sources I tried my very best to look into the resources within my ability to do my research and find out who were these Nicolaitans, which Jesus says, you hate them and I also hate them. Now the word hate here refers to a very strong resentment, repulsion. Jesus hated them, not them as individuals, but their deeds. I look into various commentaries. I couldn't find any hint of what that deeds were. What were the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which Jesus says he hated? I looked into the YouTube and find out what is that hatred about, but there is nothing much I could find. I heard the sermons from many other preachers also to find out who were the Nicolaitans. And there was not a trace of evidence to show what were their deeds. Apparently, it was a very prevalent problem in that church in Ephesus, which the church members in Ephesus hated. And it's also something that Jesus hated. And so Jesus says, you hated the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. Then in verse 7, the Lord says, he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. Now, this is the way the Lord Jesus writes his letters. He writes the letters in general to all the churches. Then in conclusion, he always says, to him, singular, individual, to him, not to all of you, but he says, to him, come back to the individual, to him that overcomes, I will give him the tree of life, to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. Now, in my observation, I think at that time, Ephesus church was one of the largest churches in Asia Minor. And there were probably about 300 or 350 members in the church. And he says, to him who overcomes, I will give him the tree of life, coming to the individual. Now, one time I was doing some studies on the book of Revelation on the seven churches. And one way of interpretation is the seven churches refer to seven Christian periods. Now, that's how Uriah Smith and many other Adventist theologians have commented. These seven churches refer to seven periods of time, starting from the early Christian church until the last church, the Laodicean church, which is during our time. And that's one way of looking at it. Another way of looking at it is to see the particular situation in that church in location in Ephesus at that time. Now, that's another way to interpret it. The third way to interpret this is to the individual Christian who believes in Christ and who has an experience of growth and failure. Growth and failure. He has his ups and downs in his Christian experience. Now, that is where our church, our members are all affected. We all go through experiences very similar to the seven church, to the seven churches expressed in Revelation chapter 2 and 3. Now, the first charge that Jesus brings to this church is, you have left your first love. There are many reasons why people leave the church. Maybe we will go through this little by little, and as much as possible, I will tell you some stories, if possible, if time permits, so that you can understand this much better. You know, people come and go. When they come to the church, there is always an experience of joy in the beginning. Then there is a time they leave the church. There is a time of sorrow, sadness, and disappointments. Now, I consider the church pastor is like a bus driver, you know. You know, bus drivers always have a responsibility to take care of all the passengers. Sometimes the church is full, sometimes it is empty. Just like a bus driver, the bus sometimes can be full of passengers, crowded. Sometimes it is very empty. But the bus travels from one location to another, to its appointed destiny. So the driver of the bus should not be discouraged. Sometimes it is full, sometimes it is half full, sometimes it's very empty. And people leave the church for various reasons. Many reasons are to be studied and to be observed, why people come to church and why they leave. And we will look into that in the form of some stories today. And we will try to understand our situation also. These are the main points. What are the reasons why people leave the church? Now, in the book of Ephesus, in the study of the church of Ephesus, this is the slide. We find that people come and go. Why do they come to church? Why do they leave the church? What's the reason? Jesus says to the church in Ephesus, you have left. The word left has to do with the power of choice. People leave because they made up their mind to leave. Now, we will look into some of these reasons. One of them is because they do not like to hear gossip in the church. Now, this is my observation. You may not agree with me, but I personally have observed some people do not want to come to church because they don't want to hear the gossips that's going on in the church. They also leave because of segregation. They feel that they are not being accepted into the church, or evil speaking in the church. Now, we as Christians and Adventist Christians, we come to church with one motive. We come because we want to worship our Creator God. We come, we worship Him privately as well as corporately, and then we quietly leave without talking about other people in the church. Now, let's make that as a habit in our church. We come to worship God. We leave quietly without gossiping. That is my advice. Okay, let's go on. In John chapter 6, we see the story of Jesus feeding some 5,000 people. You know, this was at the seaside of Galilee, the Sea of Galilee. 5,000 people were fed with fish and loaves of bread. But later on, the people wanted to make Jesus king. They wanted to see a king who can provide for them their regular meals with their comforts of life. But when they decided to make him king, Jesus quietly left their company. And they followed on from the other side of the shore to follow on to see Jesus. And then, if you read John chapter 6, verses 60 to 71, there The Bible says, from then on, verse 66, John chapter 6, verse 66, from then on, many left Jesus. Many. Because Jesus said to them very directly and plainly, you came to seek me because you ate the fish and the bread. But I am giving you my body as bread, the true bread, and my blood as your true drink. If you eat my flesh, if you drink my blood, and if you eat my flesh, you have eternal life. Now, if you read the book Desire of Ages, it is that point, and it is at that point in time, Judas Iscariot left Christ. He wanted to make Jesus king. He wanted to make him the king of Israel. He had a good ambition. Then when Jesus said, you came after me because of the loaves of fish and the bread, not because you understood what I came to do, because you came for the fish and the loaves. And then many, the Bible says, many from then on left Jesus, left following Christ. Now Jesus is a very sharp observer. He knows the motives of the peoples, their hearts. And so he said, you came after me because of the bread and the fish, but I have come to give my body as your bread and my blood as your drink. They all understood that this was a spiritual kingdom that Jesus was trying to establish. So from that point on, many left him. The Bible says many left him. And then Jesus asked this sad question, will you also leave me? He's talking to his apostles. Will you also leave me? Because I said I will give my body as your bread and my blood as your drink. Will you also leave me? This is what Peter said. Lord, you have the words of eternal life. Where else can we go? You have the words of eternal life. Where can we go if we leave you? You know, this is a very good answer. You have the words of eternal life with you. If we leave you, where else can we go? Now, the Adventist Church has many ups and downs. People leave the church. Many leave the church for many reasons. But do you know the Adventist Church has the truth in it for the last days, even though it's a very small denomination. But it has its message from the Bible for the last days. This is my conviction. And I am convinced this church is the correct church. For many years, I was in another denomination. But I found the Adventist Church, though it is a small denomination, it has its truth, the pointed truth for the last days. And so we are here. You and I are here in this church, Seventh-day Adventist Church, because it has the truth. And it is our duty to preserve the truth that we have found in Christ, in the church. Because of that, we remain faithful to him. We want to follow him on. Now, there is another story of another man called Demas. In 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 8 to 10, there is a story of this man called Demas, one of the colleagues of Paul. They worked together as laborers in the evangelistic world all around Asia and Europe. But in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 8, Paul writes this very sad statement. The story of Demas, he has left Paul. Paul was arrested for preaching the gospel. And then he talks about Demas. Having loved this world, he left us. Now, to follow the world is quite easy, you know, because it is just following the crowd. But to follow Jesus, it takes an effort to go against the crowd. And with a very heavy heart or deeply felt experience, Paul says, Demas had left us. So there is another reason why people leave the church, because they leave because it condemns the sinner and the sins. But the church is not a place to condemn sinners, but to point the sinner to Christ. When we bring people to Christ, there is always hope. There is always a message of hope, a message of salvation, a message of restoration. But people cannot take it sometimes because of the criticism, the condemnation some people have towards the church. But we should never hate the sinner. We hate. Notice there in the message to the Ephesian church, Jesus says, you hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. Notice carefully, he says, he didn't say, you hate the Nicolaitans, I also hate him. No, he says, you hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. What were the deeds of the Nicolaitans? Now, there are many speculative theories about these deeds of the Nicolaitans, but we do not know what were the deeds. The Bible is very silent about it. The Bible doesn't elaborate very much about what these deeds were, but we know one thing. Jesus did not condemn anyone. He only condemned the sin, but not the sinner. Then there is another story of Hymenaeus and Philetus. Oh, let me go back again. Yes, here it is. The story of Hymenaeus and Philetus. These are also workers with Paul. They were laborers with Paul. Verse 18, 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 18 says, this charge I commit unto thee, thou son Timothy, according to the prophecies which went before on thee, that thou by them mightest war a good fight, a good warfare, holding fast faith and good conscience. Verse 19, which some having put away concerning faith have made shipwreck. Now he's talking about those who have left the faith. Verse 20, he identifies two names, of whom is Hymenaeus and Alexander, whom I have delivered unto Satan. Now here, Paul is using a very strong word. You know, I have delivered them unto Satan, that they may learn not to blaspheme God, or the blaspheme the gospel. Now even in the days of Paul, there were people who left the faith and brought shipwreck to their faith. So it is not surprising that today many leave church and the truth. Even in the days of Paul, we have stories like Demas and also Hymenaeus and Philetus. They also had left Paul. And we have also the name of Alexander the coppersmith, who also had left, and Paul says, I have delivered him unto Satan. Now, who was Alexander, whom Paul says, I have delivered him unto Satan, spoken of as a woman with big, large breasts, many breasts, a goddess of fertility. And they made these images for sale. Alexander was one of them. He was a coppersmith, and he made good business out of the sale of images of Diana. And when he saw Paul and others come to disturb their trade, they began to fear that their business would be collapsed. And so they created a riot in Ephesus, and they shouted for more than 2 hours, the Bible says, "Great is Diana. Great is Diana, Artemis, the goddess of Ephesus." And they began to fight against Paul. Now, it must be a terrible experience for Paul to stand alone against such kind of persecution. Now, let me go back to another one. Yes. The story of Alexander the coppersmith. This is found in 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses 19 to 20. And Paul's fierce anger against Alexander the coppersmith, who was converted for a while. Then he went back to his idolatry, and he made shipwreck of his faith. Then Paul says in verse 20, "Whom I have delivered unto Satan." What a terrible, strong language Paul had. I believe Paul was a very strong-tempered man. And he said, these people have come to Christ for a reason, but when they find they don't have any earthly gain or profit, they left the gospel. And so he says, "They I have delivered unto Satan." Now, in the Old Testament, we also have the story of the prophet Hosea. You know, Hosea was a prophet in the Bible, in the Old Testament. The Bible says God told him to marry a prostitute. Now, maybe she was not a prostitute at the time of marriage, but she must be a very attractive woman. The Bible says that after giving birth to two children, apparently the second child was not from Hosea, but it was from another man, she also left Hosea. It's a sad story. You can read that in the book of Hosea. After you read Daniel, you come to Hosea. And there, Hosea was brokenhearted. He felt that his wife was unfaithful to him, and she had borne another child out of wedlock. And he began to realize his wife was so unfaithful. Now, sometimes beauty can be very dangerous to somebody, some men, because beauty attracts men. But when the beauty is gone, then comes the real character. What happened to Gomer, the wife of Hosea, was that she left Hosea because she loved other men who brought her much gifts. And one day, Hosea was walking in the market area. We do not know exactly which area was this, but it was somewhere in the land of Israel, maybe in Jerusalem. And he saw his wife being sold as a slave in the marketplace. You know, in the days of old, slaves were sold, like in the vegetables, fish, and meat were sold in the market. Slaves were sold. And Hosea was so surprised to see his own wife being sold as a slave in the marketplace. Now, the price of a slave is always around 30 pieces of silver. When Hosea saw his own wife being sold, he had sympathy for her. He bought her with 30 pieces of silver and brought her home. After that, the Bible is very silent about what happened to them. We do not know. Apparently, they did not have a sexual relationship with each other, but probably he had bought her to set her free from slavery. Now, this is how God is trying to teach Hosea God's love. God has saved you from slavery of sin and brought you out, and he still treats you like his wife. This is how it is. You left me, Jesus says, but I have bought you back. It must be a very touching experience for Hosea. to see his own wife being sold in the marketplace as a slave, and then he went and bought her back and bring her home. Now, this is the background of the story of Ephesus. The church at Ephesus had left the Savior. She has left the first love. Then there is a vivid story of Nicholas. Nicholas, we do not know much about him. I made a good study on this, a very good research on this, and I found out the Bible says Jesus hated the deeds of the Nicolaitans, but he doesn't identify what were the deeds. We cannot speculate what were their deeds. I went into that speculation realm at one stage in my life to find out who are these Nicolaitans. Then I withdrew my stand. We don't know. The truth is, we do not know what were their wicked deeds. We know they left the church because of some secret sins, but the Bible does not reveal the deeds of the Nicolaitans. The Bible simply says Jesus hated their deeds, but he doesn't elaborate clearly what were their deeds. Now, I learned something interesting about this, and that is Jesus condemned the sin, but not the sinner. Notice that carefully. We come as a church as sinners, all of us. There is nothing good in us. It is at the merits of Christ we are saved, through faith in him and his precious blood he shed for us. Not because we are good, we are saved. No. We are saved by grace through faith, not of works, lest any man should boast. And that should be the attitude. We don't want to deal with who that sinner is or what he has done, but we come to Christ and bring the sinner to Christ in repentance. That's our goal of our church. But sometimes the church does not deal with that. It deals with the bad things people do. They gossip about it. They begin to make fun of it. And this is where people get discouraged. Now, all of us are sinners. There is not one person who is perfect. All of us have sin in our lives. Do you like your sins to be published openly? Certainly not. So is in the case of Nicolaitans. Nicolaitans, they were having some kind of a sin life, sinful life, probably has to do with the flesh. But the Bible does not describe or elaborate what their sins were. Perhaps it is too shameful to do so, to explain that. So must the church be. Jesus accepts people as they are. You know, we do not want to run away from Christ because of our sins. Rather, we come to him, run to him in repentance and ask him for forgiveness. We don't know their deeds, really. We really don't know. The Bible is silent about it. And I have made a very thorough study on this. And I found out the deeds of the Nicolaitans are not elaborated in the Bible. And I don't like to go into speculation because that is a dangerous thing to do. So, in conclusion, let us summarize. We come to church to worship God. Amen. We come to church because we love Jesus, our Savior. We come to church to give praise and adoration to our Savior, Jesus Christ. Not to gossip about other people, not to talk anything bad about anybody. No, that should never be our attitude. We bring people to the foot of the cross of Calvary. We tell them, there is a Savior who forgives sin. There is a Savior who loves you. There is a Savior who comforts you. There is a Savior who knows all about you. There is a Savior who forgives sinners. There is a Savior who loves you just as you are. So therefore, come to him just as you are. and he will accept you. He will pardon you. He will forgive you. He will cleanse you with his own precious blood. Do you like to accept Christ as your Savior? Now, there are two questions. We must preserve the purity of the church. And then we must fight the good fight of faith. Not to fight with people and their sin problem, but rather the fight of faith to come to Christ, to bring our adoration and surrender to him and follow on Christ. Would you like to accept Christ as your Savior and follow him on? Raise your hand if you do like to. Oh, praise the Lord. I see so many hands going up. Praise the Lord. Shall we pray? Our Father in heaven, we thank you because Jesus is our mighty Savior. No matter how bad our sins could be, he is able to forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Lord Jesus, we belong to a church that accepts sinners, that follows Jesus. We belong to a church that loves Jesus and worships him. To him we give our submission, our adoration and praise. Now and always, in his worthy name we pray. Amen. God bless you. Our Father in heaven, we thank you because our Savior Jesus loves us. He loves the sinners, even though he hates the sin. And he has a forgiving heart to accept everyone who comes to him. And that's why Jesus said, "He who comes to me, I will in no wise cast out." Thank you, Lord Jesus, for you are a wonderful Savior who has a place for everyone who comes to you. We surrender our lives, our hearts to you now. Write our names in the book of life, in the Lamb's book of life. And come quickly, Lord Jesus, for on that day we will see you face to face and worship you face to face. And unto him who is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before the throne of grace, be glory, Lord, and honor now and forevermore. Amen. God bless you.